Hello everyone and welcome in the last session of Ajeti webinars for this year. My name is Suzana Ajeti and I'm the Ajeti Portfolio Marketing Manager and your host for today. Today's topic is Sustainability and Corporate Social Responsibility Driving Business Value. Stay tuned during the next 30 minutes and get a perspective on the business case and business value of mainstreaming sustainability and social responsibility in corporate strategy and operations through case studies and best practices from across the globe. To tell us more about it, joining us is Ms. Radhika Lalit. She is presently an associate with the Rocky Mountain Institute with extensive experience in sustainability and CSR consulting. In the past, Radhika worked as a sustainability and corporate social responsibility strategy consultant to over 30 Fortune 500 corporations in India. If you have any questions or comments during the presentation, feel free to write them in the question box in the right-hand control panel. Please, Ms. Lalit, you may start the presentation.
Thank you, Susanna. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for attending this webinar on sustainability and CSR. Before I start, even though Susanna has introduced myself, I'd love to do a little bit of an introduction again. I'm presently an associate with the buildings practice at the Rocky Mountain Institute in the New York City office. In the past, I have had significant experience in consulting, research, international development, and policy analysis. I recently graduated from a master's degree in international policy studies from Stanford University, prior to which I was working in India as a sustainability and CSR consultant to several Fortune 500 corporations. I'm grateful to PECB for this opportunity to discuss how sustainability and CSR can transform business trajectories and also drive substantial business value. My presentation today is divided into primarily three parts. The first part is really about understanding sustainability and CSR and its relevance at a systemic level in businesses. The second part is about understanding why organizations must invest in this approach. And the third part really is about providing an insight into roadmaps, resources, and the best practices to institutionalize sustainability and CSR in the business DNA. Now, so let's start. Let's start by understanding what do we really mean when we say sustainability and CSR, and how should we think about it? There are several definitions given by experts throughout the world. However, for the purpose of this webinar, I would like you to think about sustainability as an organization's commitment to be responsible and accountable to the society and the planet at large for the impact of its products and services. And I think it's only natural to expect this from a business. On the other hand, I'd like to say that corporate social responsibility or corporate citizenship or CSR, as many of us call it, is a commitment by organizations to have a positive impact on the societies in which they operate. Again, not an unreasonable expectation. I believe CSR is an integral part of an organization's sustainability strategy. And how I would like you to visualize this is by understanding the entire ecosystem. Let's put things in perspective. Businesses must understand that they operate within the society, and the society or the entire human race operates within the planetary ecosystems. Therefore, without investing in society or the planet, it is impossible for any organization to be sustainable or even in existence. And therefore, now let's understand what do we really mean when we say what is a sustainable and responsible firm. At the very outset, the purpose of every organization or business is to really create shared value. And I emphasize the word shared here because it's important that the value is as valuable to the community and the planet as it is for the businesses themselves. And at the very outset, the purpose is really to be profitable, and growing at the same time, and at the same time being responsible to stakeholders. So what does that mean, being responsible? I think in my understanding, responsibility is...
Ms. Lalit, sorry for the interruption. I wanted to remind you that please move the slides as you talk along, okay?
Yeah, okay. Sure. Is it...
We still see the first slide.
You're still seeing the first slide?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Perfect.
Yeah. Okay, great.
Okay, thank you so much. No worries.
So basically, at the very core of any enterprise, I think any responsible organization must have a staunch commitment to the society and planet. And that's something that's non-negotiable. And so you might be thinking that I'm talking about these values and ideas, but is that really happening in the real world today? Can you see the next slide, everyone? I hope you can. So what I'm really trying to convey here is that the CEOs of today's global and multinational corporations really understand the strategic paradigm and can foresee an unprecedented wave of conscious consumerism emerging. I think all of us see that trend happening. And this year, UNGC, as well as Accenture, interviewed over 1,000 CEOs on their business outlook. The study really determined that 97% of the CEOs in over 100 countries emphasized that the paradigm of sustainability was essential to the future success of their businesses. This is huge. This is a huge societal shift in the perspectives and paradigms of how businesses operate and how businesses are thinking about sustainability and corporate social responsibility. So let's try and understand the strategic reasons why businesses are adopting the sustainability and CSR paradigm. Clearly, there is a business case. But let's talk about the two big reasons why they're doing this. The first reason is really about risk and risk management. I think sustainability and CSR are robust risk management tools, and they create immense shared value. And that's the second reason. So let's talk about risk management for a second. I think as a part of risk management, it's important to understand that the society gives the businesses a long-term license to operate only when the businesses operate in a responsible manner. Therefore, social and environmental stewardship is essential to business continuity. The other aspect of risk management really is about reputation management, which is another important reason why most companies pursue these activities. However, what really happens is the myopic view of the relevance of these values and virtues and paradigms makes businesses make some mistakes. And by mistakes, I mean really view sustainability as a philanthropic activity rather than a project or a value or a strategic decision. And it's important to take note that sustainability is not philanthropy. And in fact, it is a part of business strategy itself. And that's something I'd like to stress today. Now let's talk about other risk management issues. I think managing mounting stakeholder pressure is another key risk management tool for enterprises. And stakeholders, by stakeholder I really mean shareholder, government, regulators, consumers, civil society, organizations, as well as employees. So all of these are in a way today raising their voices to ensure that the enterprise is sustainable and is walking the talk, is not just greenwashing. Now the other risk management aspect is fear of regulation and compliance. We really see that this is a major driver for organizations to put their act together and get sustainability ingrained in their organizations. However, this should not be the driving tool. The driving tool instead should be really creating value and creating value through a different approach to problem solving. The last thing that I think within this risk management is about really seeing how international organizations are putting so much pressure on businesses today. And I think that's another important aspect to keep in mind. Let's move to the second part about creating shared value. Clearly, creating shared value is now a business imperative. The society wants not only those businesses who survive and make it, but also who are responsible, who are adding more value to the society, who are driving efficiencies, who are driving growth and innovation from the forefront. From the business's perspective, they can use this approach to enhancing their branding, even retaining best talent, gaining competitive advantage, and even gaining access to responsible investment. And I want to talk to these points in my slides ahead. So let's talk about growth returns and brand equity. Research has been going on for over 3 decades now that indicates that if the corporate financial performance of an organization goes up, 13% of that can be attributed to the increasing sustainability. Further, it has been proved that sustainable organizations have the highest return on assets and even net income over time. The graph on the right of your screens really conveys this insight. And what I'm really trying to convey here is it is important to understand that sustainability has strategic benefits to an organization once it's institutionalized and once everybody's on board. So let's move to the next slide. And the next slide is really an example of how one of the organizations has been able to leverage sustainability into enhancing their revenues and even their brand equity. HUL, or Hindustan Unilever, is basically operating in India, and it has a few products. It has products like Purit, Lifebuoy, and Domex. However, what they are doing in their CSR, which is also known as Project Sunshine, is providing clean water, which is basically their product, Purit. Now, what that will do is leverage, it's actually twofold thing that it will do. It will leverage the image of a responsible organization to urban counterparts, as well as help Hindustan Unilever to brand their product or to be able to come into this new market in the rural communities where they're doing these interventions. So Purit basically provides clean drinking water, and they're installing these devices in either urban rural slums, urban or rural slums, or even for that matter rural villages. And what's that going to do is really create a stream of revenues that are going to be sustained for time to come. Let's talk about Lifebuoy. So basically Lifebuoy is a soap, and what they're doing is running a campaign around it to promote hygiene. And this falls directly in line with the Lifebuoy campaign, which really is about killing 99% of the germs on your hands. And so what that really means is that this company is thinking about corporate social responsibility in a very productive manner. They're trying to leverage that to really go into new markets, to enhance revenues, to get new revenue streams, as well as enhance their overall image of a responsible organization. Now, I did a little bit of research on how businesses are promoting, how sustainability is promoting business model innovation, and how are businesses really benefiting from sustainability as an innovative approach to problem solving. And what I've discovered is that innovative sustainability and CSR approaches have helped businesses rethink their organization's business model in a lot of ways. They've also helped create newer sources of revenue, leading to profitability of an enterprise. And what I've done here is really I've made an attempt to classify these innovative business models and approaches into several groups. These are 6 groups. And the first category really deals with shared service economy. I think all of us here will agree that this is an up-and-coming trend that most organizations see, and that this is being leveraged by organizations across the board. And examples of such organizations are Uber, Airbnb, Zipcar, Enterprise, Lending Club. Now, they're using this whole shared service economy model, thinking about how the trend of conscious consumerism is entering into our society, where we do not want to waste resources, we want to save the planet, we want to be more efficient with how we are using our resources. And so that was the first category. The second category really is based on process and product remodeling. And it's something that is common wisdom, that with resource efficiency you can also save money, but it's a common thread that everybody acknowledges. And let's give you an example. Novelis basically recycles, and it's an organization that recycles over 40 billion used cans globally every year, and it is an $11 billion enterprise. Now, this is huge, and what that really goes to show is that there is a lot of campaign around waste to wealth, around recycling, around reusing. Other examples that I can give you right now are hathi chop. This is basically elephant poo paper. It's made out of elephant poo, and this paper is sold at a higher premium. Another example here within this category is the Patagonia repair shop, where Patagonia advertises how you shouldn't buy a new Patagonia if you can just reuse and repair the existing one. I think that speaks to how the consumer is thinking about these issues, and it's very important. The third category here is pay-for-success models, where the consumer or investor only pays if the promised targets are achieved. And this is a very interesting one because it entails ESCO models where they're guaranteeing you X amount of savings. It looks at environmental and social bonds, which are collecting finances for social and environmental causes. This is also very interesting. And the fourth category really is about organizations that are committed to providing solutions for environmental and social value creation. And examples of such organizations are Tesla, TOMS, O-Power, among others. And what they're really doing is leveraging this aspect to the hilt. The fourth category really is about leveraging new sources of investment. This category taps into new sources of finance, such as crowdfunding, Mosaic, which is a solar company, as an example, uses easy-to-use crowdfunding investment model to enable small individual investors to fund large commercial solar projects. I think this is very innovative, and it uses this particular aspect. Water Credit, on the other hand, uses microfinance loans to provide clean water and toilets to individuals and communities. And there are other examples of organizations such as Fundly, which offer individuals a chance to raise money for medical procedures, schooling, or charity. I think those are some of the interesting examples in this category. Now, the last category is really, the fifth category is about removing physical barriers or interfaces and going virtual, or really cutting the middleman. For an example, Threadless is a t-shirt company that invites artists to create designs which users vote on, and then the most popular ones go into production. So you don't have to mass produce and wait for it to be sold. You can try and use this as an alternative business model towards efficiency. And so there are other examples where they've removed businessmen in a B2B transaction, such as ITC eChopal in a rural setting, and B2C business models such as this, such as what Tesla is doing, is really not having you know, the typical model for retail for cars, but just having their own you know, way of coming up with going virtual and also ordering before you produce, which is again promotes efficiencies. Now the next topic that I want to talk about here is, I've talked about innovating business models, but how has one company done it? And I think this is a very interesting example, because Simpa Networks really sells solar home systems in the state of Uttar Pradesh, and rather than finance consumer purchases to traditional credit, Simpa uses pay-as-you-go top-up model. Now this model is very similar to prepaid mobile top-ups in India, and this financing model really allows consumers to buy recharge credits for every time they want to use their solar home system. And after the customer has made over 28 months of payments, they own their system. Now, what is the impact? They have been able to provide 900,000 households access to electricity for at least 7 hours per day, which translates to over $21 million in additional incomes for rural economies. Now, these are economies that were never explored, never talked about. This is how you think about sustainability and creating shared value and really go into markets which have never been tapped before. I think this was an interesting example that I wanted to share with everyone. Talking about the market disruption, I think there is definitely something there. It is definitely good for your business. And as an example, the case in point is the grocery industry. We all know that the grocery industry is saturated as well as stagnant, but responsible consumption products labeled as organic, natural, ecological, or fair trade are basically the brightest spot in this industry. this market segment has already reached $400 billion and is likely to grow by an additional $180 billion. And these offerings are no longer niche products, but are capturing a disproportionate share of growth. In the US alone, for instance, the sale of these responsible consumption products has grown by 9% annually in recent years, which really accounts for 70% of the total US grocery sales in the US, which is, I think, huge. This is a huge disruption, market disruption in the way people are looking at markets. Another example in transforming the markets is Google. As we all know, market transformations can be led by businesses wanting to do well and wanting to do good. This follows the win-win strategy. And Google has really transformed the renewable energy space in a very clever way. Google is a technology company, and like most other technology companies, energy use in data centers and their buildings is a major expense. With the goal of powering itself by 100% renewable energy, it has really de-risked its business from future energy price fluctuations, which could be political or otherwise. And this is also a huge win for Google, because when it bought its entire portfolio to be powered with RE, it was basically a bulk purchase of renewable energy, which has really brought down the prices of corporate solar power purchase agreements substantially across the US as a whole. And they've almost signed 19 PPA agreements, reaching 2.6 gigawatts of wind and solar energy. And they're going to be 100% renewable just next year. What's also interesting is they're using their street view cars, which are for Google Maps and accurate understanding of the visual picture of a particular street. They are now installing those cars with air pollution sensors to give you an idea of what is the air quality in the area that you live in. I think that is going to change the real estate market a lot, because now people are going to talk about how good is the air quality in my area, and that is going to determine prices. I think all of this that Google is doing is transformational, and they're committed to the cause of sustainability. Moving forward, I briefly talked about how it's important to attract and retain best talent. In 2016, Deloitte survey really talks about that if you want to maximize engagement with millennials and you want to keep them as employees or customers, companies should really look at ways to close the gap, because millennials really want to contribute to the positive impact that they believe businesses have on society. But in doing so, they really want to be true to their personal values. And millennials more and more want to focus on the products and the purpose and less on the profits. And so that is the key mantra for having millennials be a part of your future consumer base or even your workforce. A 2014 Net Impact study, in fact, showed that business school graduates would like to take a 15% pay cut to work for an organization whose values resonate with them. And 71% showed that they're ready to take a 15% pay cut if they have a job in a company committed to corporate and environmental sustainability. This really speaks to the point of how it's not only important from the consumer perspective, but also from retaining the best talent. Now let's talk about another point around regulatory changes and stakeholder pressures. I mentioned that at the start of my presentation. The case in point is really India. In 2013, India institutionalized its New Companies Act, which is now a law. And the Section 135 in there really has mandated that companies with a net worth of more than 500 crores or more have to spend at least 2% of their average net profits made in the preceding 3 years for social welfare and development. Now, this is coming from a government. This is huge, because that changes the way companies now look at it. It's not just an option. Now it has to be a compliance measure. And there are reports that the private sector's combined charitable spending has jumped from almost half a billion dollars in 2013 to over $3.8 billion after the laws in enactment, which is a great jump. But this is only when 52 of the largest 100 companies have failed to spend their last 2%, their required 2% last year. So I think we're going to see more of this catching up in other parts of the world if businesses don't volunteer to be responsible. Now, let's talk about what is a roadmap for institutionalizing sustainability and CSR in your organization. I think it's a six-step process, but it's very iterative. So you can go back to the step one or go back to the last step that you did again if you don't feel that it was achieved. So the first step is really around building a team, building a cross-functional team and engaging the top management. This is important because without a team from, you know, representing cross-functional values and expertise, it's impossible to be able to institutionalize the whole process in your organization. The second step is really around identifying materiality. So what is materiality? Materiality is really what is important to you and most important to your stakeholders. So those are the issues that you should be using to implement in your CSR strategy, because anything other than that would not make sense. An example is Coca-Cola, or Pepsi for that matter, are the beverage companies which require a lot of water. And so what is important to people, their stakeholders as well as them, is water. And they have been taking water from the groundwater aquifers, so they should be they shouldn't be held accountable for how much they're extracting from a particular watershed. And so this is an important aspect to understand. Always work around what is important to you and your stakeholders. The step three is really around strategizing goals and values. It's important to have goals with clear timelines, set deliverables, as well as assigned responsibilities within the organization. You know, this creates a sense of purpose, and that's very important for the success of CSR. Now, the fourth step is really around stakeholder engagement and communication. This covers a broader category of ideas, but the idea really is to incentivize and engage both internal and external stakeholders to brainstorm solutions for CSR. When everybody comes together, there is definitely a lot of goodwill created, there's a lot of energy created, where people are willing and more passionate to do things for this cause. And so it's important to have everybody on board and create a strong communication campaign around this. The step five is really around prioritizing and implementing. You will not be able to do everything within the first year, and that's understandable. But what you can really do is pursue the low-hanging fruits and identify partners for your implementation. And another very important aspect here is you don't have to do everything by yourself. What you can also do is engage with partners, engage with people on the ground, and do a lot of capacity building for them so that they can be able to undertake this roadmap successfully. The sixth step is really around being able to measure, report, verify, and communicate outcomes. I think anything which is not measured is not managed, and it's important to review and communicate the results transparently on key metrics to measure progress and share them with all your stakeholders. Now, the next aspect that I want to talk about is, all right, these are the steps, but what is the prerequisite for successful sustainability and CSR interventions? And I have in mind six things that I think will definitely lead to success. I think the first one is very clear. I think there should be a vision, mission, and value alignment with the organization. It's very important that whenever you're hired into an organization, you basically are vetted for what the organization values are and what you stand for. And once you're there in the organization, it's important to understand the pulse of that vision, mission, and value, and then move forward with those interventions which align to these value systems. The second point really is about organizational priority. Get your CEO on board. There is no second way to be able to be successful in creating sustainability if you're top management, or especially if your CEO is not personally engaged, involved, and invested in this mission. Get to talk to them, get build support. You can go bottom up or top down, but the idea is to build support and ensure organizational priority for CSR, because a lot of times people just don't have that in mind. The third point really is around building a passionate team. So third point is really around building a passionate team, and the fourth one really around sustainability, KPIs and incentives. Ensure that, you know, if you have goals on sustainability, that they are a part of the KPIs, so that people who are working for it feel motivated and incentivized for this. And the fifth one really is around building SMART goals. SMART goals are definitely specific, they're measurable, they're achievable, and you report on them as well.
Ms. Radhika, can you please share your screen, because I think you closed it by mistake.
Can you see it?
Yes, I can see it now. Perfect. Thank you. Continue, please. Okay.
Sorry. And the last one really is around building a communication, comprehensive communication plan, which ensures sustained communication to both your internal and external stakeholders. Without being able to communicate, you will not be able to generate more interest, more passion in the next generation. And so that's a very important point as well. So I'd like to end my presentation here and really provide some conclusion points on this. Sustainability and CSR offer strategic systems approach for solving business problems and driving business value. I really feel that better sustainability practices attract higher shareholder value, greater margins, even higher brand evaluation and customer adulation. Not only that, you'll be able to attract the best of the talent. And last but not the least, I'd like to say that it's not an option anymore. It's not philanthropy, and it's a prerequisite to business continuity. Thank you. And I'd like to now turn it over to Suzana. Suzana, are you there?
Yes. Thank you very much for this presentation, Ms. Radhika. Before we continue with the questions, I would like to inform all the attendees that the PCB provides training and certification services for ISO 26000, Introduction, Foundation, Lead Implementer, and Lead Auditor. ISO 26000 turns ideas into actions and provides guidance on how businesses and organizations can operate in a socially responsible way. A PCB certificate will demonstrate your dedication in implementing and managing these processes and frameworks. And what is most important is that you will be recognized worldwide. For more information, please visit our website, pcb.com/training. So Ms. Radhika, we have some questions. The first question is a charity program same as CSR?
No, I don't think so. I feel like sustainability and CSR both have to be handled on a project management approach, and that they are not philanthropy, or they're not in any way related to just a one-off. What it is a new way of problem solving. It is about contributing to society in a sustained manner, not like a charity, but like a project management. Or a project. So I think that's something that is worth keeping in mind, that do not look at sustainability as a charity. Look at it as creating business value. Look at it as from the perspective of generating more consumers, generating more revenues, and involving your customers as well as involving your employees.
Thank you, Ms. Lalit. The second question is, how to convince any company to implement corporate social responsibility?
Well, show them examples. There's so much being done across the board. I recommend that you see the speech by Indra Nui, who is the CEO of PepsiCo, who's talking all about sustainability in her new speech. And she understands, and I think most CEOs understand, that it is important to business continuity. And if you want to convince or build a business case, start with the low-hanging fruit. When I was consulting organizations, I would always start with building the case for sustainability by bringing up how much, like the benefits, like quantify the benefits that you would get from such a strategy, build a business case for it, show the return on investment, and sooner or later you will have buy-in. So I think that's what I would do. I would present case studies, I would quantify the benefits, I would definitely engage my peers to talk about it so that the top management pays heed to it.
Thank you once again for this presentation, Ms. Lalit. It was our honor having you as a presenter. I would also like to thank all the attendees for taking the time out of their busy schedule to join us. We received all your questions, and because the time is limited, we will answer to your questions individually by email. I would like to inform you that from the January 2017, we will offer free premium webinars with global professionals and the hottest topics. Subscribe to our YouTube channel in order to stay updated on what is coming. Till next year, we wish you a Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays. Bye.